I've been watching protests in this city for 30 years. I've been covering events in this city for 30 years. This was not a great day for democracy in Toronto. I saw things I'd never seen before. I saw things that frankly should not have happened. And people will come to their own conclusions about what they believe the state of democracy to be in Toronto and in Canada as a result of what happened. It was a sad, bloody day, I'll tell you that much.
Ontarians deserve answers. Ontarians deserve respect. Ontarians deserve, Speaker, a public inquiry to get to the bottom of what really happened in Toronto during the G20 summit. That is the bottom line. Otherwise, we risk setting a terrible, terrible precedent.
Well, let's go down the list. Laws were changed without public input. The public was misinformed about broadened police powers. Unconstitutional searches occurred across the city. Excessive force was used to disperse peaceful protesters. More than 1,000 people were arrested, held in an overcrowded detention center, and not allowed to call their family or a lawyer. More than 900 of them had not done anything wrong and were subsequently released without charge. Never have we witnessed before in this province such an outrageous and aggressive attack on fundamental freedoms and on basic and clear charter rights. We reverted to barbarism on June 26, June 27.
You know, Ontarians have paid very dearly over the years for this right to collectively gather and voice their opinions in freedom and without being accosted by law enforcement and police. They've had this right since the founding of our province, Speaker. It must be respected and it must be protected.
Don't be so grouchy.
Get back! Move back!
Police in Quebec are being accused of using undercover agents to provoke violence outside the North American Leaders Summit in Montebello, Quebec, earlier this week. Police are not commenting on the matter, but protest organizers say they have the video evidence to prove it. They claim officers acted as masked demonstrators who attempted to stir up the crowd at a legitimate protest and went way ahead or beyond their duty to keep the peace. CTV's David Aiken reports.
These protesters are not yelling at the lines of uniformed police officers. They're yelling at what they say are three undercover officers dressed up like them.
Our line.
A protest leader is worried the three will get violent.
Put the rock down, man! Put the rock down!
The three refuse to identify themselves.
These three guys are cops, everybody!
Other protesters say they are provocateurs trying to start a riot.
They want us to be aggressive with them.
Trapped, the three push back and then try to bust the police line and are arrested.
Now, all of that happened on Monday. 2 days later, the Quebec police force refuses to comment on the incident. If anybody was arrested, no police agency is releasing their names or even confirming the arrests. Union officials say that's proof the three were police officers or their agents.
In a free and democratic society, people have the right to peacefully protest something they don't like.
Police routinely plant undercover officers at demonstrations, mostly to learn about routes protesters will use or to determine if there are any weapons. Information police say they need to ensure everyone's safety. This retired officer is skeptical the three were police officers. He says in his 25 years of policing protests, he's never seen undercover officers act in such a clumsy and dangerous manner.
I'm finding it very difficult to believe that any police commander for any police service would ever sanction that kind of an intelligence operation.
No. Put the rock down, man! Put the rock down! Put the rock down! This is our line! Get out of town! Cops out of town!
Communications, Energy and Paperworkers Union President Dave Coles was confronting these three masked men with rocks and bottles and accusing them of being police officers. You can see from this footage that they were intent on starting a riot. Watch as the gloved hand of one of these provocateurs hits a member of the riot squad in the face mask. Now watch as he changes hands with the rock and then bangs it into a riot shield. These masked men were attempting to violently disrupt an otherwise peaceful protest. They were breaking the law and violating the constitutionally guaranteed rights of the protesters.
They're trying to create a riot so that they can suck us all in and get beat up.
Yeah, people often
How do you know?
I stopped him, looked him in his eye and said, "You're a cop, aren't you?" And his eye just glazed right up. I tried to take his mask off, we took it off. We got pictures. They're provocateurs.
The action of these three masked men and the reaction of the riot squad was highly suspect, but ultimately it was the matching boots that gave the provocateurs away. That night I posted the footage on YouTube. For the next 4 days, it was a national and international news story. The Sûreté de Québec denied any involvement, but on the fourth day, they finally admitted it was their officers.
As we confirmed yesterday, the three people in question were indeed Sûreté de Québec police officers performing their duties.
Three guys are cops, everybody!
Busted. Three Quebec provincial police officers, identities masked, one carrying a huge rock.
Hey, put the rock down!
Nabbed for infiltrating a peaceful protest at Montebello. The tip-off came from a union leader who noticed riot police standing by despite the obvious weapon. He accused the men of being undercover cops trying to provoke a riot and end the protest. The men were removed but never charged. After 2 days of questions, the Sûreté du Québec issued a news release late today confirming, yes, the men are police officers, but denying they were agents provocateurs, claiming they were sent in to identify and stop trouble. They say the police refused to throw stones, committed no crime, and were there to maintain order and security.
Wait a second. This is not a proper use of police resources, and we should be setting guidelines.
Activists have argued for years that police try to thwart their legal right to protest by trying to incite aggression so they can move in and take protesters away. They say they do it even when demonstrators gather in a designated area, as these mostly unionists were in Montebello. And they say politicians tacitly endorse it.
This is the face of it, where people can't even ask a question without having to face these kinds of goons.
The Supreme Court has ruled protesters have the right to be seen and heard. Tonight, both the Quebec and federal governments are facing calls to do more to police the police. Susan Bonner, CBC News, Ottawa.
It's being called Fortress Toronto. Several downtown blocks of Canada's largest and most populous city have been wrapped in more than 6 kilometers of zinc-coated fencing. Pounding the pavements in and around the 3-meter-tall barriers are thousands of officers who are keeping a watchful eye out for any potential threats as the leaders of the world's largest economies meet in Toronto for the G20 summit. The billion-dollar price tag for security alone is a controversy the government is struggling to contain.
So many things could have been done with that money. And am I upset? Yes, I'm upset.
Good afternoon. As of right now, if you need to be downtown, you need to be ready to identify yourself.
That's right, because police have some new powers. If you are within 5 meters of the outside of the security fence, you're going to be asked for ID. If you refuse, you can walk away and leave the area, but if you refuse and you stay, you could be arrested. CTV's Paul Bliss joins us now from Queen's Park. Paul, you were just down at police headquarters where Chief Blair was speaking with reporters, and the chief says these arrest powers are not new. They go back to perhaps 1939.
Yeah, the chief and I had a bit of an exchange going this morning because I was trying to get clarification from him. The act that grants the police these powers has been in effect for decades. However, these powers were only granted to police on June the 2nd. But the problem was it was done without police or the government notifying anybody. Essentially, what happened is the chief went to the politicians, the Liberal government at Queen's Park, and said, "I need special permission under an act that the government has has. It's called the Public Works Protection Act. He says, I want to be able to arrest anyone within 5 meters of the fence if they don't provide proper identification, if they don't allow me to do a search.
We know that securing Toronto city center against all those anarchists and terrorists can get very boring. So we are here to remind you that everything is okay, that we are on your side. We are the love police, and our job is to lower fear and raise love.
We can ask them to leave, and as you all now know, we have the authority to ask them to leave the interior of the perimeter area and then 5 meters from that fence.
You're within 5 meters of this wall, so please turn off your video camera.
We can't film within 5 meters of the wall?
No, that's correct.
Okay.
Public Works Act states that, so please.
Because we're
show your right? Identification please. These officers.
Failure to identify yourself under the Public Works Act is going to end up in you guys being arrested.
They will not be arrested. They have a right to not identify themselves. Again, I would invite you to read the act because what you're saying is not true.
Right? So could who's got
is can he you, being detained right now or
he's just talking. Same thing that I've okay. asked you to stop filming, brother. Come all on. Right.
Let me clarify it for you. By all means, if someone comes to the fence and seeks entry, they will be asked to identify themselves. If they refuse, and they have a right to refuse, then they may leave. And they will leave without being arrested. If, on the other hand, they try to force their way in, they can be prevented from entering. That's a very different thing than what you have described.
Okay, so your friend didn't want to tell the police who he was, so he's been arrested for the time being, okay? Right now, he's just been arrested.
So what's their arrest for?
For failing to identify himself.
On Tuesday, it emerged that special police powers that the media reported had been given to police for the duration of the summit, powers that the Globe and Mail suggested were unlimited, had in fact never been given. Although a temporary regulation was passed in secret on June 2nd, making the fenced-off security zone around the summit subject to the Ontario Public Works Protection Act, the so-called 5-meter zone that supposedly gave police the right to demand identification from anyone within 5 meters of the fence never existed. When asked on Tuesday if the 5-meter rule had been in effect, Toronto Police Chief Bill Blair said, quote, "No, but I was trying to keep the criminals out," end quote.
There's no official protest here today yet. The big one is tomorrow, but already we're seeing some evidence that police are using that new power that they have under the new regulation. Joining us now is Tara. You were here in the park earlier. What happened to you? Did police say something about this new rule?
Well, basically, we were just met in the middle of the park. We sat down to exchange some phone numbers. And within about 10 seconds, about 10 police officers had surrounded us, had basically asked us to open our bags so they could search them. And my two friends said they did not consent to the search, and they enacted basically the new Public Works Act and said, you have to basically open your bags and we have to be able to search them. So they searched our bags, also asked for our identification, and wrote down all of our identification as well as phone numbers.
When they mentioned this new Public Works Act, what did they say about it? Did they say, well, we can arrest you, or what?
They basically told us that it allowed them to open anything and search anything on public grounds. As to what public grounds means, they weren't really clear, but they said anything that was considered a public place, they could ask for identification and could search us. But there's no protesters in the park today, and so I was just kind of shocked that 10 police were surrounding us when we were writing down phone numbers.
Well, what about the fact that there is no fence here? I mean, a lot of the explanation was that if you're within 5 meters of the fence, you could be searched. There's no fence here.
I'm not sure why exactly we were searched, and in fact, there was no fence here. I haven't seen a fence for at least a couple kilometers, so I'm not quite sure why we're being searched here or why there is so much police presence, but we definitely, this act was invoked in us.
What this legislation does on its face is that it gives the police the authority to ask a citizen to identify themselves who happen to be in downtown Toronto, and they've designated a whole area of downtown Toronto, and to have a police with the authority to force you to identify yourself without any cause whatever is frightening. And then it goes on to give them authority to search the person without any cause.
Which means the whole right to privacy and the right to probable cause is gone on the search. You just have to be within an area.
Within that approach, as it's called.
And as we'll learn later, that's a pretty flexible thing. Just what is that area?
That's right. So they could designate, for example, the whole of downtown Toronto as a public work, and then public protest would be prohibited.
I think it's kind of also extraordinary that it's not just police officers who can enforce this act. It's something they're calling guards. But the most important thing that then leads to is every person who gets appointed this way has the powers of a peace officer. He can turn almost anybody they want into
a
policeman.
That's right. And, of course, we saw earlier this week or the previous week where there were a number of private security people that were going to come to Toronto to deal with the G20, and they weren't even licensed in Ontario, so that we've got people here that could be not licensed or they're quickly licensed. In other words, if people read that if they went downtown to protest, that some rent-a-cop guard could arrest them for whatever, neglecting to follow their instructions, then people may say, you know what, I don't need that. I think I'll stay home and so on. So the chilling effect is also crucial.
So the right of free assembly can be gone in a snap of cabinet's fingers?
In effect, a snap of cabinet's fingers behind closed doors.
So this is pretty dramatic stuff, because the law was not only passed in secret, but it was kept secret. This is the stuff that Kafka wrote novels about. Secret laws that the citizenry isn't aware of are the hallmarks of tin-pot dictatorships.
Okay, guys, this is my undertaking to appear. There's me, and I got arrested on the 24th of June. Neglect to comply with the direction of a peace officer, because I've broken the law, Public Works Act, brand new law, just to fuck over people like myself, Section 5-1. Yeah, so here I am outside the old courthouse in central Toronto. They held me for 20 hours following my arrest yesterday at 3 p.m. by Staff Sergeant Reynolds, badge number 3061, on the most bullshit charge of not providing my ID when asked to do so by an officer of the law. The guy didn't really give me a chance to give my ID. I tried to reason with him for a second. The next thing you know, the handcuffs are thrown on. I get taken into a holding cell, into a pen, where I was handcuffed with the cuffs behind my back for 4 hours, and they wouldn't loosen or release me from the cuffs. Even when I went to the bathroom, I still had to wear the handcuffs. I'm slightly traumatized by the whole event because they really treated me with absolute discourtesy and disrespect. I got taken after my 5 hours in the cuffs to the Toronto Film Studios, where they set up this massive warehouse where they're holding G20 Toronto protesters prisoner. And it was, as I keep saying, very traumatic. It's very, very scary when you're by yourself in that situation. I'm out, I'm safe. They didn't rape me, only mentally. So I'll see you all soon. Take care.
Benina and Queen, main intersection of Toronto, and it's just being taken over, sworn by some really radical anarchist activists right now. I've never seen Toronto like this before, so this is definitely a first for all of us here. So I think something's going to be happening soon, because I'm seeing a lot more people covering their faces, a lot more of the black blocks, covered head to toe in black. Everyone seems to be getting ready for something. The more radicals are kind of clustering over here.
Thank you. Why do you think you're
here for? Look, why is there a handful of cops there and a handful of cops there? There's fucking four of them. It's probably the police that are in there doing this.
My name is Joe. I'm a photojournalist. Yesterday I was following the protest against the G20 summit and I started to follow the black bloc. As the end of the protest reached Queen and Spadina at around 3, somewhere between 75 and 100 black bloc members rallied. They left the main protest and started quickly back down Queen Street, heading east. On the way, they encountered two police cars with police in them, which they attacked, broke windows. There were riot police at the intersection of each street that went south from Queen Street into the financial district, but they didn't engage the protesters. They just watched them go by smashing windows and spray painting. From there, they turned south on Bay Street and started into the financial district. There were three police cars abandoned in the intersection at King and Bay. The black bloc started smashing the police cars and set one of them on fire. After around 15 minutes, they walked north on Yonge Street, smashing windows along the way. There were no police to be seen anywhere. The streets were full of people going, just kind of doing normal things. At 4:20, they reached College, where they smashed more windows on their way back to Queen's Park. They also smashed some windows at a police station. When they arrived back at Queen's Park, they had all huddled in a circle to remove their black clothing. And then after that, I just lost track of them. They kind of just blended into the crowd or disappeared from that area altogether. There are lots of other peaceful protesters in that area since it is the designated protesting area. I found it really strange that we'd followed these guys 24 blocks over the course of an hour and a half and there was no police presence, no police interference. We were in the financial area, We were in a highly commercial area, and there was people just going about their daily lives. And after seeing so many police on the street over the last week, it just seemed very strange to me that there was absolutely nobody along kind of one of the main anticipated protests of the summit.
A room filled with police officers stare at pulsating screens. Feeds from 85 cameras cover most of Toronto's downtown core. This was the command center for the G20 Integrated Security Unit. It may have been Toronto police on the streets, but the feds ran the show. At some point over the weekend, the operational commander watched the action unfold on the monitors in front of him and made two fateful decisions. The first was not to immediately move some of the thousands of available police officers into position to stop 100 or so people from breaking store windows. More importantly, not to quickly stop the trashing of several police cars. CSIS had decided there was no credible terrorism threat. The whole rationale for all the security was that a small segment of protesters, known for the day as the Black Bloc, would cause some property damage and might try to storm the security fence. Yet when the windows broke and the police cars burned for perhaps as long as an hour, there were no police in sight. Watch the CP24 coverage of police cars on fire Saturday night on Queen Street. The journalists ask over and over again, where are the police?
And Farah, tell me what police are doing right now.
I don't see any police here, Anne. That's the thing. I don't see any. I don't see even one unit around. This is just protesters and smoke coming out of this vehicle.
What happened to the two lines of several lines?
They dispersed down Peter Street. So again, there's no police officers here.
That's right, and that's curious. They were just there in you know, two rows
it's
deep.
En masse.
Dave Woodford, OPP Sergeant, joining us on the phone. Dave, I don't know if you can see the pictures right now. Sergeant Woodford, another Toronto police car on fire. Police seem to be letting this happen. There were a lot of police and riot here on Queen Street just a minute ago. Now they're gone. What is going on here?
Well, I don't know if it's protecting the vehicles or not. I think it's the security of the people and around the area. We have to make sure that when one of our vehicles, like we're seeing right now, are put up in flames, that we have to make sure that the security of the people around those vehicles, you know, we're not going to save the vehicle. It's already on fire, so we have to make sure of that security.
Dave, looks like
step in and ask, why are police not there right now?
Each officer has been given a specific detail where they're to be, and you can't let your guard go down on another location where there could be protests because there's maybe a vehicle on fire. We have to keep our grounds and keep the, you know, make sure that all locations are kept safe.
This is what they're riding around in. They're not riding around in cop cars. Interesting, because there's cop cars all on fire. These guys are just standing around while that car is burning. Here's where all the cops are. There's a car around the corner that's burning. And all the
and
guys.
And everybody's okay with this.
They're just hanging out.
And just chilling.
Drinking. The people are standing around an exploding car.
Look, you know what? They abandoned
them. They abandoned them on purpose.
The cops, they stole
the car. Superintendent McNeil told his hometown paper, the Cape Breton Post, quote, "We have the ability through our video feed to see everything that's going on. There are even helicopters and planes providing video feed. We can see them from the air. We can see them from the ground. If there's anyone trying to interfere, we would see that." Well, we know the police had infiltrated the Black Bloc. Now we know the cameras could see everywhere. So why couldn't the police defend their own vehicles? Was this part of a plan? Or a lack of available resources, as the police have said? Only a public inquiry can answer this question. Television images of police cars ablaze set the stage for mass arrests. And now joining us, Clayton Ruby, who's a renowned leading Canadian constitutional and criminal lawyer for decades in Canada. Thanks for joining us.
Pleasure.
And I should add, a member of the Order of Canada. And
thank you.
Because what we've seen right now is, to all effective purposes, if they arrest 1,000 people or more and then don't charge them, they've eliminated the right to protest and free assembly, but it's never going to get tested in court because they just drop the charges. They, you know, they can go fishing and throw the fish back and nothing ever comes of it.
Bear in mind that your idea of what is a norm of Toronto policing
is not based primarily on any value system the police hold that respects individual rights to protest. They seem to have none. It's based on limited budgets. And what we've seen here is a picture of the police state to come. What happens when you give the police unlimited budgets? All the men they want, all the toys they want, all the machinery they want, and the right to control huge swaths of the city. That's the police state that's going to come if we give them the money to do it.
Which apparently we did.
Which we did on this occasion, and which Mr. Harper wants to spend another $8 billion on prisons. That's the other end of this. So watch out for this police state. It really will come with money. And there's nothing to stop it, because those values of liberty and freedom and democracy are not cherished by the police departments.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the New World Order.
I think it's very important to stress to those in uniform and to those in the dark suits in government who are serving this system while not actually instigating it, they're serving it. You have no power. I don't care if you're in the military. I don't care if you've got how many kind of stars on your uniform. I don't care what level of the police force you're in. I don't care if you're doing roadblocks. I don't care if you're pulling people off the street. I don't care what you're doing. You have no power. Your uniform has the power. Take your uniform off, okay? Put it in the wardrobe. Where's your power? Go and get another job. Without that uniform, where's your power? You have no power. You are employed to animate that uniform, which is an extension of the state, and that's all you are, and therefore you are expendable. While you give your soul away, while you give your mind away, while you give your morals and decency away, advancing this fascist dictatorship, you will be okay with the fascists that you're serving. But your children and your grandchildren have to live in the world you are creating. And one day you're going to have to understand that, and I don't envy you that moment, because it's going to be horrific when it dawns upon you the world that you've actually created. The people in uniform and the dark suits that administer the system while not being the originators of it, they have to start breaking ranks, okay? Get some backbone, open your mind, look at what's going on, and get some freaking backbone before you administer and impose and enforce a world that will be grotesque for your children and grandchildren. In fact, not even that, for yourself.
After about a half an hour, the riot squad started to move into the protest zone, and another group of riot police came from behind Queen's Park and surrounded the protesters. They squeezed the protesters and bystanders as they pushed us back, hitting us with batons. They hit me in the back and my field producer in the hand, breaking his finger.
They broke my finger as I was trying to walk away.
Go on your knees.
And they were also pepper spraying the protesters at that time. We knew we were going to try and follow the black bloc, so we wore helmets for protection. But we actually wound up needing them for protection from the police, more so.
was standing here exactly like this.
And they shot you with this.
I was like that.
And they shot you with a plastic bullet.
In the knee.
They didn't believe you.
Oh, look, it made a hole right through my shorts, too.
Oh, fuck, dude, that is going to be bumping tomorrow.
There, to the best of my knowledge, has been no use of other use of force options like rubber bullets. I'm aware that that's been twittered by a number of people, but that, like much of the information being put out by these anarchists, is misinformation in order to mislead the public and the media.
With respect, Chief, I got an email from a political operative with a picture of one of these bullets on the street. So could it be that some they're being used without your knowledge?
No, I would be advised if those devices were being used. I have been at headquarters all day, and I have been in contact with the incident commanders. The use of those devices, now I'm aware that those devices are deployed on the street, but I have not been advised that any such device has been fired at any individual.
So with my daughter and I, we went to Queen's Park. It was around 6 o'clock. And we had sat down there with two other young men. We didn't know them, but we sat down with them. And we were talking, and we were there just sitting there. And we were only there for a couple of minutes when the police line moved up to us. And I heard one of them, one of the police said, move. So we were all trying to get up. I was sitting on the ground, and I was trying to get up, and the two young men were trying to help me. And then I lost my balance. I fell back down. And then the police were, I guess they were, you know, wanted to get us pushing to get us going. And Dad and my daughter told them, you know, leave him alone. He's an above the knee amputee. Let him take his time. And I was trying to get back up when one of the police shouted, get the four of them. And then the next thing I know, they're just piled on top of me. The police pinned me down. One of them felt like they had a knee right on my left temple, and they were grinding my head right into the ground. My glasses came loose, and one of the police said, you're resisting arrest. And I said, I'm not resisting arrest. I couldn't move at all. I couldn't move like a centimeter. I was just pinned right to the ground. And they ripped my hands out from underneath me, forced them behind my, put them behind my back, and put on these tie wraps really hard. My glasses were laying on the ground, and they didn't seem to care, so I grabbed them with my mouth. I held the glasses in my mouth. And then one of the police, they ordered me to stand up or to walk, and I said, I can't. And then one of them grabbed my prosthetic leg and ripped it off without any explanation. He ripped it off, and then he ordered me to walk, and I just looked at him. Obviously, I couldn't walk, and then he said, hop, and I couldn't hop, and I said, I can't. I never hop. It's very painful. So that's when he said, one of them said, you ask for it, and then two of them grabbed me underneath my arms and started dragging me away across the pavement, and my elbows were digging right into the pavement, and I was screaming at the time, and I'm still trying to hang on to my glasses in my mouth. And so they dragged me, I don't know how far, but they dragged me a bit of a ways. And then they dropped me, and some other police came up, and they hoisted me into the air. They picked me right up, and it was sort of the same routine. You know, they were hitting me. They were accusing me of resisting arrest. One of them, they were saying I was a spitter, that I had a weapon and things like that. These were all untrue. I couldn't resist arrest. I couldn't do anything. But they dragged me to where they had their paddy vans or paddy wagons. They threw me on the ground. They did some more hitting and kicking me. So anyway, then they threw me into the van, and then I was taken to the detention center.
John Prine. John Prine's a constituent of mine. I know him. He's 57 years old. He works for Revenue Canada, for Pete's sakes. And he's an amputee. He lost his leg in a farming accident 17 years ago. He was sitting on the lawns at Queen's Park, which so many people have believed was sort of a safe zone. Not safe to commit crimes, but safe to be removed from any of the fray that was going on out there. And he was attacked by police officers, arrested, handcuffed, had his prosthesis torn off his leg.
I guess I'm just shocked, still shocked about the whole thing, and we need a public inquiry to clear the air on this.
I was protesting amongst other people, and I was swarmed by riot police who then threw me on the ground. One of the riot police had put their foot on my head to push my head down and informed me that I was resisting arrest when I wasn't. At this time, I had already said to them, I'm not resisting arrest, please don't hurt me. There was a number of riot police that were taking my bag off of me. Someone kicked me, someone was holding my legs down. I had a few of them that were holding my arms, saying I was resisting arrest when I wasn't. And then eventually they got my hands behind my back because they asked me to. I put my hands behind my back, and they then put the zip ties on my hands, and which were really tight. I was losing circulation in my hands. At this point, one of the riot police officers had pulled my hair and pulled me up off the ground by my hair. At this point, a number of them had brought me over to the paddy wagon and threw me up against the paddy wagon. One of them said that I was getting ready to spit. I said, no, I'm not getting ready to spit. They said, put your hand on her mouth. One riot officer said for me to stop moving my head. It was virtually impossible for me to stop moving my head because he had my hair and he had my head looking up at the sky. The other riot police officer then put his hand over my mouth, and I told him I wasn't gonna spit. He told me to shut the fuck up. A number of them, they kept saying that to me. They kept telling me to shut the fuck up. They told me that I was provoking the people, and I was telling them, I was trying to tell them I wasn't. At this point, now, while they have my head pulled back and a glove over my mouth, they then searched me. It was a male officer that rubbed both my breasts and went down and rubbed my private parts and rubbed my other parts and all the way down my legs. And after that, they said that they asked me if I wanted my bandana cut off my head hair. I said yes, please. And so at this point, they were telling me not to move because they were going to cut the bandana from around my neck. At this point, I have already urinated myself because I was so scared. And now I'm thinking they have a knife and they're going to have it around my neck and cut my bandana off my head. I'm sorry, it was very traumatizing and scary to experience that. I have no rights, and that I'm vulnerable as a woman, as a person.
Welcome to the Real News Network. I'm Paul Jay, reporting from the G20 in Toronto. Now joining us is Steve Paikin. He's the host of TVO, used to be known as TV Ontario, which is the major public broadcaster in Ontario. The show is called The Agenda. Thanks for joining us.
Sure.
Now you've been a current affairs broadcaster at TV Ontario for 18, 19 years. Mm-hmm. Have you seen anything like what you've witnessed this weekend in terms of the police?
I saw a crowd of people very organically just sort of gathering on Yonge Street. It was a very peaceful group of people, actually. Came together quite organically. There was no ringleader of it. No people with masks on. No people with signs. It just was people coming together.
So none of this black bloc look?
None of that. None of that. We had seen earlier in the day people with masks on their faces, trashing stores, torching police cars. This was the furthest thing from that. This was a group of people who had a very simple message, which is whether the G20 is here or whether they're not here, we ought to have the right to freely assemble and freely speak in this city. There's a history of that in the city of Toronto, capital city of Ontario. And that's the message they were trying to get out. So they wandered around the streets. There was, I don't know, maybe a couple thousand of them walking down Yonge Street. you know, moving onto some side streets, walking around for about an hour, would come in contact with a police line, would turn around and go somewhere else. This wasn't a group that was looking for a confrontation. In fact, there were a couple of moments during the course of it where they came to the big fence, which of course is well known as surrounding the whole G20 area. And I thought to myself, okay, here we go. There's 100 police on the other side of that fence, and some crazy person is going to try to scale that fence right now and get themselves on TV. Didn't happen. They got to the edge of the fence. They sang their songs. Peaceful protest, that's what they kept saying. And then they turned around and went somewhere else. At one point in the evening, crowd is a little smaller right now. There's rain every now and then, so the crowd was thinning out a bit.
What size is the crowd at this point?
It's probably down to 500 or 600 at this point. They find themselves trapped at the base of one of the biggest skyscrapers in the city, the First Canadian Place. And there's a police line, police all clad in riot gear on one side, police line on the other side, and they got nowhere to go. So they sit down. Everybody's making a peace sign. They got nowhere to go, and they don't want any trouble. And all of a sudden, for no apparent reason that I could tell, because it certainly didn't appear as if the police were threatened, their safety certainly wasn't in jeopardy, there was no potential damage to property or other lives, the line started to move in. And
how many police?
I'm going to say probably, 50 on one side, 30 on another. And
shields, batons?
Oh, yeah, and guns. I didn't know what they were firing, but at one point, they started firing on the crowd. Probably rubber bullets, maybe just, but it was definitely pop, 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 pop.
Now, Chief Blair of the Toronto Police Service has said there's been no firing of rubber bullets. You saw something being fired.
I asked, I felt it whiz right by me, and it was repeated. And I don't know what it was. I couldn't swear it was rubber bullets. I asked the police afterwards, because I had my media badge on. I asked the police afterwards, what's in those guns? And they said smoke bombs and rubber bullets. So I'm assuming that's what they had.
And these are at 500 or 600 people sitting.
Yeah, they scatter. Needless to say, the crowd goes off in any number of different directions. But then the police backed off, and somehow the crowd reconstituted itself after a while. Walked further south towards the G20 area. Stopped on a side street called the Esplanade. The Esplanade's it's kind of a thin street. You've got a large hotel on one side. You've got a bank of restaurants on the other. Well, at that point, kind of history repeated. 50 cops, maybe more than that, maybe 75 cops on one side, taking their batons and smashing their shields and moving in, establishing a line. Same thing on the other side. The protesters aren't, I even hesitate to call them protesters, because they weren't really protesting. They were sort of gathered as a crowd and once again sat down on the road making peace signs. Most of the time, not even chanting, just quiet.
So the police are doing that. This is usually the symbol of intimidation.
It works, believe me.
And it's usually when you're up against demonstrators that are being very aggressive.
Yeah, there was no aggressive demonstration here. It was just a peaceable protest. Anyway, the police lines start to move in further and further and further, and clearly they have everybody surrounded right now. And there's nowhere to go. And it then got quite bizarre, because one line came in and said, get out, get moving that way, leave. And the other side of police line kept coming in and saying, get out the other side, leave. And the protesters are saying, we don't know where to go. You're telling us to go this way, you're telling us to go this way. What do you want us to do? Where do we go?
Eventually, we got sort of corralled down at the Novotel in front of the Esplanade.
Yeah.
I never saw one bit of violence. In fact, they started arresting people while they were singing Give Peace a Chance.
And at that moment, I just thought it would only take one idiot protester or one idiot police officer to do something stupid before this got really dangerous. And it was very scary.
And then they were just closing in, so I decided this is getting a little too much. So I was on my way to leave. As I was walking by, the riot team attacked me and were like, you can't leave here. You chose to be here, we gave you a chance to leave. I'm like, I didn't hear a single chance to leave, and nor did anybody here. And this is my first day even living in this town, can I please leave? And they just pushed me out of the way and said, do you want to make me use this on all of you? And she had a tear gas gun in her hand. So I just continued and sat down with everybody. They just kept swarming in, and then just decided to announce, we're arresting all of you. You had the chance to leave, we gave you a chance, you're done, you're gone.
The riot cops sort of corralled us all in, blocked off both ends of the streets. They never said, leave now or you'll get arrested. There was actually no word. I tried. There was Calgary riot officers. I tried saying, can we go? Because it's starting to get a little bit scary. And that was our thing, was that we didn't want to get... I'm not a lawbreaker. What did they say? Smash, 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 stomp, stomp, stomp is what they said. No communication other than banging their shields. They got us into a semicircle. A couple came out of the keg. Which is there, and sure. They tried to leave, and they got too late, bang on the shield, and the guy's like, too late for what?
A couple came out of the keg restaurant.
Yeah, the keg
just
restaurant.
Across the road from the hotel.
That guy ended up in my cage, yeah. There was a guy that was trying to show his ID. He lived in the condo there, and he got pepper balls shot at his feet, and he has to escape into the Novotel. You can catch him on the YouTube video. If you do Novotel, you'll see all these people running inside, and you'll see this guy who's just outraged because he lives in the condo, and he's trying to go home.
I live here, what do you want me to do? I was like, back off, and start shooting at me.
Oh, man. I heard the bullets flying.
See that? There you go. Yeah. What the fuck is this? Anyway, Pepper, that's...
At that point, a couple of police officers came up to me and said, okay, you got to go. And I said, but I'm here doing my job. I'm with the media. Here's my G20 accreditation. And they said, well, you can stay and report, but we'll arrest you if you do. Or you can go, and we'll take you off site, and you can leave. So at that moment, I thought to myself, I'm not going to be able to do a lot of reporting sitting in a jail cell, so okay, I'll go. As I walked away, these two police officers escorting me away from this site, I see 5 feet away from me a reporter by the name of, I later found out his name, I didn't know it at the time, Jesse.
Is it Jesse Rosenfeld?
Jesse Rosenfeld.
We know him because he's done some work for us from the Middle East.
Okay. He's reporting apparently for The Guardian. He doesn't have a G20 ID badge, he has the Guardian ID badge. So the police officers say to him, one grabs him by one arm, the other grabs him by the other arm, picks him up, drags him over, says, we're going to take your badge, we're going to check and see if you are who you say you are, and wait right here. He had no choice to wait right there. They were holding on to him. Jesse wasn't rude and he wasn't belligerent, but he continued to press them. Why are you detaining me? Why won't you let me do my job? I'm here from The Guardian. It's a reputable newspaper. Why, you know, why? He kept going like this. And they took the badge. One officer left, presumably to do the identity check. He continued to push the officers by asking them, why am I here? What are you doing? Why won't you let me do my job? He was completely immobilized. Jesse's like 5'5", 140 pounds. I mean, he's a scrawny little guy. A third police officer wearing T-shirts and shorts, not riot gear, walked over and just hauled back and gave him one right in the gut. And Jesse doubled over.
This is while he's being held by other policemen.
Jesse fell down face first onto the ground. Same officer then came, elbowed him right on the back. And he's obviously out of commission at that point, and I think screaming as well. The officer who was escorting me away at this point, I mean, we both saw it, looked at me and said, geez, that shouldn't have happened, shouldn't have done that. And then I was kind of rushed away.
And at this point, we were definitely cornered, and it had been a while. Presumably, people would have left if the police had let us leave, but we were totally sealed off, and there was absolutely nowhere to go. And on a couple of occasions, they told us, leave, go home, which was very, very hypocritical because, yeah, we had absolutely nowhere to go. A lot of people, probably a lot more than half, collapsed into the entrance of the parking garage of the Novotel. And a group of us, maybe about 50, stayed in the middle. Still maybe a couple of chants going on. And at that point, they just started snatching people and disappearing them behind the police lines.
Frankly, I don't know why it had to happen. I think there's a distinction that needs to be made between people who only want to destroy property and torch police cars and are wearing disguises so you can't make out their identity, and they have a kind of orchestrated, strategic approach to, you know, damaging property and harming people. There's that. And then there was what I saw, which was middle-class people of all ages, a very diverse crowd, just trying to make a point that whether the G20 is here or whether it isn't here, we don't necessarily give up all of our civil rights to speak freely and to assemble. That's the only point, as far as I could tell, and I talked to probably 50 demonstrators over the course of the night, that's the only point they were trying to make. And for trying to make that point, several hundred of them ended up in jail, and a few of them got beaten up.
Where were you taken?
I was taken, drove in a minute and a half in a dark paddy wagon to a prisoner bus, which then was taken to the Eastern Avenue Detention Center.
What time did you get there eventually?
I guess I got there maybe around 1:30.
In the morning?
Yeah.
And what time were you released?
I was released maybe at around 10 o'clock the next night. Were I was held for 24 hours in handcuffs the whole time.
Oh, the next night?
Oh, yeah, the next night. I was held for just before the 24 hours you can legally hold somebody.
Were you fed, given water?
I was held in handcuffs about 8 hours. I was put into a cage that was 10 by 20 with 40 guys. You may have heard them say, these are meant for 10 guys. We understand sometimes there was upwards of 20. I was in there with 40 guys and one 16-year-old kid. They had a 16-year-old kid in there with 39 men for 24 hours. About 8 hours in, we had to start begging for water. We had to, you could hear all the other cages yelling for water.
This
we had to start a water.
Very hot day, wasn't it?
Yeah, we had to start a water riot. A lot of these, like I'd been in custody since 10:30, and now it was almost.
Fed?
We were fed about 12 hours in, but again, you had to riot for that as well.
You got riot. What do you mean?
You had to start shaking the cages. Everyone was yelling, water, water. They'd either laugh at you or say they were working on it.
Well, they claim it was very difficult logistically to get water to so many people.
Oh, really? Because when we came in, there was skids upon skids of water bottles, and what we got was a jug of blue water on an office rolly chair with Dixie cups, where they would do a little squirt and hand it out to each prisoner, when there was just skids upon skids of Gatorade and water. Never got an apple or orange. I know that was in the footage. It was freezing cold in there. It was kind of unbelievable. The officer who dropped off the last guy, the 40th guy, said, how many guys are in here? And we're like, there's 40 guys in here. And they're like, what do they think this is, Auschwitz?
Anyway, so to proceed now with, I guess, the time spent in the first cell, me and most of the group, but like about another like 7 or 8 of us, stayed in that cell for 12 hours. Of course, like as the repeated stories, none of us got phone calls, none of us got contact to legal aid despite asking for it several times. Conditions-wise, it was very psychologically confusing, I guess. Like the floor was very cold, concrete floor was very cold in the room itself. The bright lights were constantly on. We had no idea where what time it was. So it was a very strange atmosphere. We got water after a few hours, but very small portion. Again, like despite asking several times. And food, again, was very scarce, and we had to ask for it several times.
The only thing we really got was like a little Dixie cup of water twice a day, and it was like lukewarm. We also got sugar-free, like, little same thing of lukewarm Tang, and we would get 2 sandwiches a day with just a piece of cheese on it. That's all we got every day. And the lights were on 24 hours, so nobody really got any sleep. The first pen that we were in has an outhouse with no door, and there's 40 people in this little room when there's only supposed to be a maximum of 15.
These cells would have one bench. I know mine was sort of standing room only. You had to take turns if you wanted to sit. In her cell, all the porta potties in there had the doors taken off. And so if a woman had to go to the washroom, all the male officers could watch. So what they would have to do is...
But did they watch?
Yes. So what they did is they formed something called... They would call out wall, and all the women would form a human wall. And because everyone was still handcuffed, they had to help wipe each other. And I eventually, from begging for water, passed out in my cell. I fell over. I don't really know too much what happened. They refused to come in and get me. My cellmates had to drag me to the door. I was apparently given some watered down juice and put back on a bench. And that's when I remember having the ringing headache. The guard that gave me the juice, my fiance told me, came over to their cage, and broke down and started crying, saying, I don't know why you guys are in here. This is wrong. And we had similar incidences with 2 officers at ours as well.
So we assumed that we were being released, but they just in fact brought us to another cell. So again, like a very hard time to get food again in that cell and water. No information whatsoever, basically the same thing. We had a mate in our cell who's diabetic. And on 2 occasions, he wasn't doing well, like his blood sugar was low. They took him out and brought him into the infirmary and gave him a couple of insulin shots, I assume, but always brought him back to the cell. And every time they brought him back, within an hour, he was feeling sick. He wasn't feeling well again. And it got to a point where he was feeling so bad that we were trying to get him water and he was shaking. And he was like, clearly he was losing color. He was not doing well at all. And we were obviously calling for attention, yelling out at them at this point for quite a while, half an hour, 40 minutes, until he finally collapsed off the bench. At that point, finally, they got people and brought him out. And we were yelling at them to actually bring him to the hospital to hospitalize him and not just to get him and throw him back in the cell again. And that's what they did. They took him out for about 10, 15 minutes and threw him back in the cell again.
I was inside for about 26 hours, I guess. At the 24th hour, I demanded that I to be released because that was my rights, and they assured me that my rights didn't apply in that building. And
why? What did they justify?
That's all they said. They're like, sometimes your rights just don't apply here. So I'm like, oh, I'm pretty sure they apply everywhere, but if that's what you want to think. So after I was released, they were describing how we would have to go into like a holding cell. And then I mentioned my boyfriend, and he said, oh, you are a part of the gay community, are you not? I'm like, yes. And he's like, well, the people in here don't really take too kind to your type, so I recommend you act straight during your visit here, and once you leave, you can act the way you choose. And then just kept going on. He's like, actually, I'm going to put you and your boyfriend in a segregated room. And it was just a little stall. Like, it looked like a dog pen. And there was a whole line of just gay people in these, like, one-person things. There was, like, a lesbian couple. There was me and my boyfriend. And then there was two separate lesbians that were just put there just because they were gay. But they didn't admit that. But they were put there for their own safety, like... The entire group was not homophobic whatsoever. The only people who were homophobic in that building were the police.
It's just absolutely unbelievable. Like, and obviously, when either some officers on the inside are starting to become sort of a little bit more sadistic or sort of enjoying that controller role, and others are breaking down and going into the I'm just following orders, I'm just a pea in a pod, something is wrong. Like, I'm not anti-protester, I'm not anti-police, I'm pro-truth. One of the things they said, I think Bill Blair said it, is that everyone was recorded from the moment they stepped into that place to the moment they stepped out. And we actually had to read a sign as we were coming in saying, all audio and video of you will be recorded. And there was a camera right above watching us the whole time.
Well, that's standard though, isn't it?
Yeah, that...
And, for your own protection.
Yeah,
well.
Exactly. And my position right now is release the detention center footage. Released the closed-circuit television footage from the streets.
Why would they have to do that?
Why would they have to do that? Well, if because what there's the statements that they said was that we understand these cages are built for 10 people. We understand sometimes they're upwards of 20. They were fed regularly. They were watered regularly. Why not? I wasn't. I was in a cage with 40 guys. I passed out and was denied medical attention. I want people to hear the recording of that Toronto Police Service's officer saying, what do they think this is? Auschwitz. Mm. And then I want people to say that an inquiry is not required. So whoever was in charge, whoever was calling the shots, failed all those officers and failed all the citizens involved.
Again, those watching, and I know there'll be people watching now who are saying, oh, yeah, it's all one-sided. Imagine if you're from a different political background, you were on a pro-life demonstration, or you were protesting against some left-wing measure, and the police treated you this way. Please don't get the idea that the police are particularly political. I think often the police can be, and they should be, quite robotic. It's the law, and they will enforce the law, and if they're told to go beyond that, they might go beyond that. I know many police officers, they've told me, think the whole thing was a disaster, they're ashamed, they think their reputation has been sullied. This is wrong. This is wrong.
I've always had a positive experience with the police, and suddenly this has completely changed my view on everything.
Benjamin Yao was walking to work. He's a TTC collector and was in his uniform. He says there were no protesters in sight, but police were blocking an intersection, so he started walking the other way.
They basically just knocked me down, and another one came and held me down, and they started handcuffing me. When I was being arrested, I mean, they wanted to know if this was the tool that I was going to use on them.
What is this?
It's a transfer punch.
Benjamin was taken to the Eastern Avenue Detention Center and told he would be charged with resisting arrest and breach of peace.
It was sheer terror. I've never experienced anything like it. I had 4 cups of water in 36 hours. I was crying, but I had no tears. I was so dehydrated. This was a form of martial law, as far as I'm concerned.
Our cameras interviewed Benjamin moments after he was released early Monday morning. He had been in custody since Saturday night and had been told all charges against him were dropped.
I can't believe this happened. Like this, just absolutely shocked. I don't know what to say. Don't know what to say at all.
Leaders have made their stand, and outside the red security zone, police and protesters have made theirs. It has been another day Canada's biggest city won't soon forget. Smiles and friendly waves as nations back Canada's plan to bring global economies and deficits under control. But just a few blocks to the east, more ugliness on the streets. A confrontation outside the center where people are being detained. While downtown, store owners are cleaning up and counting their losses from yesterday's violence.
The people united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated. The people united will never be defeated.
Six or seven officers charging towards me to arrest me. They basically, I didn't resist when they picked me up, threw me on the pavement once. I was able to put my right hand down to keep my face from hitting the pavement. Then I was picked up very violently and kind of dragged up. I was thrown down again. I had been basically snatched by uniformed officers. At that time, four men in plain clothes then took me, sort of threw me towards an unmarked van. If you can picture this, the middle seat of the van was actually folded down so that there was a space to lie on, essentially. I was thrown in and jostled around. I was put on my back so that my feet were towards the end of the van and my head was towards the passenger seat and the driver's seat. And one of the officers, who I know to be Officer Kevin Antoine of the Division 52 in the Toronto Police, Kevin Antoine is badge number 7880. Officer Antoine then sat on top of me. Another man who I have no idea whether he's a police officer or not. No one ever identified themselves to me as a police officer. The second officer then, Officer Antoine was punching me in the torso after I was thrown in the van. The second officer then actually went and choked me and dug his thumb deeply into my carotid artery. And I almost went unconscious. Then Officer Antoine was just continuing to sit on top of me and sort of shifting around, sort of treating me like an inanimate object. My throat was held for about 10 seconds. I very closely tried not to lose consciousness at that point. At that point I lost bladder control and urine seeped into my clothing. Then I did not go unconscious, and the other officer released my throat. At that point, that other officer then punched me in the head very hard. I still did not lose consciousness. At that point, Officer Antoine then sort of started patting around me and said, why is she wet? To the other officer, and the other officer replied that I had urinated on myself. And at that point, Officer Antoine then expressed disgust and scooted further down my legs. He had been sitting again over my pelvic area. So at that point, Officer Antoine then continued to verbally assault me, was using a variety of very, very gender-specific terms, very sexually charged terms. They're terms that I do not want to repeat out loud. So Officer Antoine then continued to go ahead and verbally assault me, as it took several minutes to pull into the police station. I had been flipped over on my stomach by that point, and he actually threatened to punch me in the nose as well and break my nose if I did not keep my face down towards the carpet. I was in a very vulnerable position, and I consider myself pretty lucky that things weren't actually worse. I stand with all of the women who have been assaulted and whose rights have been violated during the G20.
That's what they shot at us.
All we are saying is give peace a chance.
Hello, this is Lacey MacAulay. I am here in Toronto, Canada. And I just wanted to happily report that yesterday I faced the charges in the Toronto court of assault of a police officer, which of course I did not do. And the case was very promptly withdrawn. Basically, the prosecutor said we have no interest in pursuing the charges. So, I'm a free woman, and that leaves me free to actually press charges against my attackers. So, thank you everyone for your wonderful support, and be well. Thank you.
One of the largely untold stories of the G20 are the events that took place in the community of Parkdale, just west of downtown Toronto. Parkdale played host to the Convergence Center, where those coming to protest the G20 could meet, eat food, and sleep. In the early afternoon of Sunday the 27th, the Toronto Community Mobilization Network held a press conference. This followed the previous afternoon's smashing of corporate storefronts, banks, and burning of police cars. But the conference organizers were there to talk about the police actions against people, which at that point had included a series of violent mass arrests, home raids of activists, accusations of illegal searches, and assaults. While the event wrapped up, word arrived that just a few blocks to the east, the police were surrounding the Convergence Center. When we arrived, they had sealed the area around the building and detained a small group. People from the community gathered around to see what was going on.
I have an opinion! Arrest me too!
Yeah!
We have opinions! Arrest us!
Cute.
I think it makes people smile.
My name is a mystery.
Oh?
No, I have nothing to hide.
If the bubble touches me, I'm going to be arrested for assault. Do you understand me?
Bubbles.
Yes, that's right. It's a deliberate act on your behalf. I'm going to arrest you. Do you understand me?
I understand.
Right, you're going to be in handcuffs. All right? You either knock it off with the bubble, you touch me with that bubble, you're going into custody. Right?
I'm putting it away.
Right, thank you.
But I would also like to know...
You want to bait the police, you blow that on me or that other officer, and it gets in her eyes, it's a detergent. You'll be going into custody.
I understand.
Do we understand
that.
Each other?
I do. I would
and put it away.
I am doing that at this moment.
Right.
I really appreciate it.
Discussion's over.
If we could treat me with a bit of respect.
I just did.
Okay.
I just did.
I...
You got what you deserved. You got my respect. Right?
I don't feel very respected. I'm just...
That's terrible.
Trying to
That's
keep people happy.
My heart bleeds.
Mine too.
Right?
I'm here.
Put it away.
Right.
Knock it off.
Yeah.
For $1 billion, it could have got someone with a better attitude.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
She hasn't done anything, and you can talk to her in a very polite way.
I was
trying.
It's called professional.
Excuse me?
The incident gave rise to a popular series of parody animations on YouTube that depict Officer Bubbles in a series of situations arresting people at will for made-up infractions of non-existent laws, evidently intended to satirize the original bubble-blowing incident. Now, Officer Bubbles has launched a lawsuit against YouTube users to sue them for comments and videos because, according to his lawyer, the free speech of anonymous commenters on YouTube was inciting death threats and threats of violence against Officer Bubbles. The lawsuit also attempts to compel YouTube to reveal the actual personally identifying information of the users who are anonymous and have been identified in the lawsuit by their YouTube handles. One of the people named in the suit, a YouTube user known as Pussy McFats, but who has publicly revealed himself to be Todd Mara, a married father of two from Hamilton, Ontario, wrote a comment on one of the Officer Bubbles videos, quote, "Officer Bubbles probably looks at himself in the mirror a lot," end quote. It's unclear exactly how this could be perceived as inciting anyone to violence or how bringing a lawsuit against someone making such a comment disproves the observation in any way. In fact, Mara was quoted this week in the Toronto Star as saying, quote, "I'm a compassionate person. I don't think he should be ridiculed forever because of this. I was done with this in June. I left my comment and never thought about it again," end quote.
Somebody from the community who knows that I'm a lawyer said, "You're the lawyer, you've got to get down there, there's somebody who needs you." So I came, I immediately identified myself to one of the many police officers, and he came back to me after about 20 minutes and said that the person did not want to exercise his right to counsel, despite what I had heard from at least two other people.
Then police began to encircle the crowd and put some onlookers under arrest.
I knew that this was a situation very much in flux, so I stayed put where the police officer had told me to stand. I think that following their advice was the best thing to do in that circumstance. Turns out I was wrong.
That's when the lawyer who came to provide counsel to the detained was herself detained.
A large police officer grabbed me by the arm and shoved me into what later turned out to be the kettling area.
I'm just walking by and he started hitting me. He locked us in here.
The police started pulling people out, saying things like, "You, you've got a number on your arm. You're under arrest. You, you've got a bandana around your neck. You're under arrest. Backpack, under arrest."
What is this?
Obstruct.
Ouch.
Obstruct.
Ow!
She's good because
we got
conspiracy to commit mischief.
Media, behind the line, please.
They were pulling people out at random, just giving those very simple yet clear yet illegal reasons. And I actually saw a police officer put a young girl, she must have been about 18 or 20 years old, into a chokehold. It picked her up so her legs were dangling off the ground, and while she was screaming, he said, "You're under arrest for having a number on your arm," and he pulled her away. The real irony is that we told people to do this so that they could have access to counsel, and it turned out that people were actually being arrested for having those numbers on their arms.
Over the next few hours, many community members gathered to denounce the police actions.
Where's your warrants? Where's your arrest warrant?
There's a lot of people being trapped by police who were trying to leave a situation. That's what I see. And that's kind of crazy. And they're arresting people who are doing absolutely nothing.
We don't want this in Parkdale. We don't want an occupation in Parkdale.
Parkdale,
we just like to know what's going on. It's our neighborhood.
For the entirety of the operation, neither the media, those detained, nor concerned community members were told what was going on.
To be there in the middle of my neighborhood, surrounded by a few hundred police officers, is something that I never thought would happen to me in my life. My father was a police officer. I've grown up with them. I don't even have the typical criminal defense lawyer mistrust of the police. If anything, I have to be careful not to give them the benefit of the doubt too often. But this is the first time in my life that I have been so afraid of the police.
Some people were told they were suspects in the previous day's broken windows and burnt police cars.
I was just getting on my bike to leave, and they said that somebody over there pointed at me and said that I was part of yesterday's fires. And then they went to go get him and apparently couldn't find him, and then said that I can go.
They eventually told the bulk group of us that we would be allowed to leave as long as we provided identification to the officers and as long as we allowed searches of our bags. Huge breaches of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms that I could go on about for hours.
After arresting roughly 20 people, the police left the neighborhood. The Real News spoke to some of those who had been detained.
They thought we were passing a weapon. One of the police officers dragged me to the side. I turned around to face him, to talk to him, and he instead grabbed my other arm, spun me around, kicked me, kneed me in the ass, and then threw me on the ground and dragged me. Then he grabbed me and put me against a car. So a woman came up. She started searching me. She just lifted up my top in front of everybody, my bra and all. She didn't care who was looking. She didn't care if I was being exposed. She told me I was a baby. What these two cops did to me was like completely outrageous.
In my case,
My real beef was the way I was treated, mostly. First of all, the fact that I was being detained without doing anything, without breaking any law. And secondly, because I was made fun of. That was the part that was also insulting, personally. They made fun of my nose. One of them told me I have a banana on my face. And another guy said that my nose is going to have a hard time handling what's going on. And I don't know if this was a reference to my, hooked nose or something, but that's what happened.
It's a very small little community. So I think that when people were walking past, the shock of seeing the police officers in our little community was huge. And I think that's what really got people saying, get out of our neighborhood.
Ladies and gentlemen, Toronto is in police state lockdown. You are free to do as you are told. You are free to have your bag searched arbitrarily. You are free to hand in your identification. Please look up to your nearest CCTV camera so your face may be reported. You're all guilty until proven innocent. As long as you comply, show your identification, allow your property to be searched arbitrarily without a warrant, you will be safe. Obedience equals freedom. Slavery equals independence. Remember, you are not a unique and beautiful snowflake. You are a flesh and blood consumer. People are waking up philosophically, politically, and spiritually to the fact that we've been lied to every single day of our lives. This is a message which includes my message to the police. The people who control you are the same people who control us, and they do not care about us. And when the time is right for them, they will treat you with the same disrespect. They are using you guys. Thank you for being scared of terrorism for the last 10 years. We promise you the September 11th attacks were exactly as the corporate mainstream media told you. Do not do your own research. Doing your own research is very boring. Let the television and the newspapers do your research for you. We promise you the governments of this world have no reason to lie to you. I would like to apologize to the mainstream media cameramen here, because obviously with these messages you can't broadcast any of these things on the mainstream media, because your job isn't to educate the people as to what people here at the G20 actually think. It's to portray us as violent, dangerous people burning police cars. There are many Al-Qaeda terrorists here, dressing in Toronto police uniforms. Please be very careful, these people may assault you. They may put metal brackets on your arms. They may even ask for your identification. Be very careful. Trust no one. Why are you blocking peaceful protesters off every 100 meters? Why are you not letting people walk freely in Toronto? If perhaps a member of the police public relations department would like to be interviewed by one of us, you can maybe explain to us why you're blocking us off like this.
At first, when we were starting to make our way down to Spadina, we were blocked off by a line of riot police. And then they decided to let us go. So they moved away. There was nothing violent. It wasn't like they decided to let us go through. They actually escorted us down Queen Street. On their bikes, and again we were chanting very peaceful things. It was nothing against the cops, it was just about the issues. So finally we got to Spadina, and they blocked off Spadina. So we just kind of sat down. Some of them were singing O Canada, very peaceful. We had peace signs up, and then a line of riot police starts circling over here. So I go up to one of the police. I go up to one of the police and I ask, is there any way we can get out? We don't want to be caught in this. How can we get out? They never once told us to leave. I've been hearing Chief Bill Blair say that they told us 3 times. Not once did one police officer say, leave the premises, because if they did, I would have been gone.
It appears a group of peaceful protesters here on Spadina have offended the G20 leaders. They're upset at us for standing right here.
Yeah, we're just a bunch of people here peacefully protesting. I don't think, especially today, I've been here for a while, there's been nothing violent at all.
These cops keep telling us which way to go.
Yeah, we're kind of
violating our rights.
We're surrounded right now. There's a bunch of cops there telling us to go this way, a bunch of cops there telling us to go this way, a bunch of cops there blocking off that way. I don't know where to go.
Now they're actually cornering them in. I don't know if you can see, okay, I'm gonna zoom in. So there's cops in a line straight across the top of Spadina. They're cut off along Queen Street, they're cut off along Spadina, and Queen Street East, they're cut off there. You can see the riot cops. So they have nowhere to disperse to. Just for the record,
a line across Spadina there now. They are just
blocked. No, that's what I'm saying. They're completely blocked in. So this is an overwhelming show of force. Look how many cops there are marching in now for the amount of protesters. There's even more. This is Queen Street.
Is Chris looking more coming in?
So the next army here. Okay.
Army
here. Look how many guys are here. Even more, like, and that's on top of all these guys and all those guys. No, you can't see them coming out of Queen yet, but they're coming, man. They're fucking coming.
We are surrounded. Nobody threw anything today. No one threw anything today. So why are you provoking us? Why are you provoking us? Just tell us where to go. You're saying back, they're telling us to come here. So where do we go? They just told us to come here.
They're singing Yo Canada. So those riot cops actually just prevented people from leaving.
Oh, because they want to go forward.
No, they want to fucking be able to hit them and shit. It's just a fucking disgrace. Not a single protester has done anything violent. I'm fucking shaking. I can't hold the camera.
People who don't know much about Toronto to know that the elite of Toronto belong to a club called the Empire Club. And so it's only fitting that they would have a security design like a, oh no. This is the threat right now. Everyone's gonna be arrested if they don't leave, yet there is no exit. They want us to move, but there is no exit.
So seriously, if you wanted to get out, you would get arrested.
Yeah.
Out of the circle.
I think so.
Yeah, the guy just asked me, can I go through? And he wouldn't let him. So what's the point?
What are they doing to these people? What are they doing to these 30 people, 40, 50 people? Where do they want them to move to? Where do they want them to move to?
What's wrong with you? Are you fucking?
They're absolutely not giving the protesters a way out, and they're hitting the protesters. He hit him with his shield. And it wasn't a defensive, it was a...
Peaceful! Who's the one armored with weapons?
But your safety go home!
Where do we go? You got us locked in. If we can,
are we supposed
now,
to dig our way home? What's wrong with you guys?
We're not your enemy.
Honestly,
why are you here? The world's fucked up.
You're just trying to be here. Is that why you're just
unbelievable?
Here?
I'm sure.
And they're gonna cuff everybody that's in that group. And then I believe they're gonna work their way up there.
Oh, yeah, they're pulling them out.
Yeah, and then I believe they're going to cuff all these fucking people. But there are definitely guys here. And there are these plainclothes officers with green armbands. That guy in a purple shirt's wearing one. It's reflective. Right there, walking down the center. And the guy next to him has a reflective armband.
We're not worthy! We're not worthy! I'm sorry!
Yeah, those guys I was telling you about with the green armbands are just swiping everybody right now, and they were targeting certain people. They didn't let anyone leave, eh? They came in here 45 minutes ago and had already blocked off the end of the road. All exits. That's insane.
And this was around 6:30 when I got put in the paddy wagon. Then one cop, we were there for about 2 hours. It was raining. It started to rain before we actually got inside. So by the time we were in, our clothes were soaking wet and they had cranked up the air condition in the vehicle. So we were freezing. They wouldn't allow us to go to the washroom. They wouldn't allow us to, there's one woman who started hyperventilating and they wouldn't allow her to leave. She was like, there's like holes in the door. So she was trying to breathe through there. Then I got moved to another one because one police officer said that's overcrowded. You can't do that. Then I got to move to another one, which had the same amount of people in it. 10 women to one 2 meter by 1 meter, like steel cage pretty much. And there was one lady there who was 50, she was 59 and she had a kidney condition where she only had a certain percentage of her kidney working. And she told the cops, can I please go to the washroom? If I don't go to the washroom, my kidney will burst. And they said no. So there was two women and they ended up having to pee themselves or pee on the floor of the paddy wagon. So we were stuck there for like 3 hours with the smell of urine, freezing cold. We asked them if we could just step out for some air because there were so many women and they would shut the door so it was completely dark. I mean, you couldn't see your hand in front of, and you're just trying to huddle with the woman beside you. It was a desperate situation, and the cops were just joking around, making funny remarks at us. It was dehumanizing completely.
Go back now to Sammy Katz. He's our special correspondent inside this human box that's detaining but not really detaining him right now. Sammy, what's the latest?
The latest is that it looks like Disneyland right now, except like a very black version of Disneyland. People are lining up, waiting to be arrested in the pouring rain. They're boxing people in every morning. People just want to go home. So at this point, they're just putting their hands in the air and waiting their turn. The problem is that the riot police don't have the capacity right now to take everybody away. There's probably something like 200 people that I can see that are arrested. They don't have the capacity to arrest everybody else that's here right now.
Look at that rain. This is all part of the story right now. The heavy downpour. These people are being detained at Queen and Spadina in the pouring rain. They're soaking wet. They're cold. They're chilled. There's even pets in that area where they're being held.
You know, if there's anything you guys can do, if you can keep contacting the mayor for people here. I'm not the only one. I'm standing next to people who are just walking by, just taking pictures, just trying to see what's going on. They already took the protesters away. They took them out of the crowd about an hour and a half ago. And now this is just people, somebody was walking their dog, another couple was going out for dinner. You know, I was just taking pictures. A lot of people were just walking by, and now we're stuck in the rain for the past 2 hours, freezing cold.
Well, the public sentiment on this, it's not good, I can tell you that. And we need to hear from the police chief, the mayor, someone who can speak to this situation. That seems absurd when I'm looking at a woman in a tank top standing in the pouring rain with her arms held behind her back, threat or no threat. Processing this way seems very, very strange.
Now, in terms of, you were mentioning, Stephanie, the number of people that were not commenting. Well, I did have one police officer who spoke to me just off the record, and I said, hey, what's going on right now? And he says, the wagons are coming. And I said, well, what about the people? What's going to happen to them? And he said, if they're in custody, they're going in a wagon. And those are his exact words.
They're in the plastic handcuffs. They are being moved into the bus and shipped to the detention center, or at least the processing center, down on Eastern Avenue. There are still about 150 to 200 people just standing in the pouring rain, corralled by the riot squad, for no reason, no handcuffs, just standing there, not being given any water, not allowed to take bathroom breaks, not being told anything, not being given any explanation, not being asked any questions, just simply being held in a downpour. And you can see them shivering in the pouring rain. It is cold out right now.
We were just like go by police, but they've chartered buses and there's hundreds of people on these TTC buses. They've let us go. I can barely feel my legs. I'm still soaking wet. It looks like they've been severely embarrassed in this situation. They have six chartered buses full of protesters, and they're taking them to the detention center now. It looks like they didn't have the capacity to take all of us, and they've let a lot of us go. Everybody's cheering. Everybody wants to go home. Everybody's soaking wet, and they just want to get out of here.
What do you want to say to Police Chief Bill Blair about this?
That was ridiculous. It was the worst. I don't feel safe around police anymore.
And so they finally, I guess they really couldn't take us anywhere because they had no space. They were trying to, we hear them on the phone trying to like see if they could take us to 32 Division or the Eastern Avenue is completely full, and they had no space to no spot to take us. So they ended up letting us out around 10:30 at night. Right where we were detained, we just sat in the back of the paddy wagon for 4 hours for absolutely nothing. It was a complete power trip on so many levels. Like they were able to say and do anything to us. And knowing that we had no, absolutely no power. So, yeah.
Why is the G20 important? Well, the 20 finance heads of the industrialized world then come in. $1.2 billion is being spent in Canada. It's a total police state. Laws are passed so citizens have no due process and can be arrested. People are grabbed. They're secret police on trains, spying on everyone. People are just taken away for no reason. That's the headline. Secret law passed allows unlimited arrest. And then, magically, the anarchists show up. The police stand back, as is in these new videos, let them set police cars in fire that are parked there, and then let the media see it, and then they pull back and are left alone. And they've been caught in Canada hiring provocateurs to attack police so they can beat the hell out of Canadians. I mean, Canadians have an evil government, and they need to wake up to it.
Alex, I really do wish you were joking, but you're not. It is absolutely correct, everything you just said. It is a repeat of Nazi Germany, except now they have a million times more powerful technology to treat us all like sheep.
Well, look at how their TSA kill people all the time, just beat them to death. You can't speak English, and you're begging for help after 20-something hours in the terminal. They just beat you to death. Go ahead.
Alex, I just hope that you have advance warning when the actual roundups begin, because I don't think we're actually that far off from what I can see.
And the media does two things. They go and point cameras at police and government provocateurs to demonize all the protesters and say, oh, look at these anarchists who are engaged in violence, as a way to cause a chilling effect against all demonstrations. And it's working well. But they also point their cameras always at foundation-funded communists and say, oh, it's communist against capitalism protesting the banks. The big central banks promote communism for the general public's wealth, which then goes offshore to them. They promote collectivism at the lower level. And this is not capitalism having central banks stealing trillions of dollars from us, but this is all part of the semantical deception where the lies are just in the basic terms and the rules of the political game we're given are lies.
Yeah, it seems to be a big turning point, but I guess all these events are big turning points. But we need to speak out to the good people who might be working alongside the G20 puppet masters or in the police. Why are the good people not speaking out? What are they scared of? Why are they under this control?
Well, they feel like they're the winners. They feel like they're on the winning team. And even if they lean towards liberty a little bit, they still think it's safer to sit on the sideline. No, things are too dark. Things are getting too serious, folks. We're entering a very dangerous time. All of you need to do whatever you can, whether it's getting information out. If you're a police officer, you know about a unit of police that was assigned to help these private contractor anarchists come in. Just like they used an anarchist to start World War I or an anarchist to bomb Wall Street. That was the bankers doing that. An anarchist is just an agent of chaos so the system can come in. I don't mean an anarchist in its true sense. I mean these people calling themselves anarchists are normally just communist youth brigade people brought in by foundations.
Absolutely, Alex. I like to call myself a philosophical anarchist. I believe in the true ideals of anarchism against big government. But these Black Bloc children, most of them were very young, they were just there, oh, we're here to commit crime. We're here to just smash things up. They're just idiots.
That's why you don't see big people, you know, big crowds out demonstrating. It's simple. You go out and demonstrate now. And especially against the globalist or the World Trade Organization or anything New World Order, they just hire thugs to come burn a police car, and then they retreat and the police attack you. And they put it on the news that you did it.
Yeah, I'd just like to just touch upon that as well, Alex. I'm just so proud of the Toronto residents and the other associated protesters for the incredible restraint they showed amidst such police thuggery. The New World Order, they want a violent response from the public right now to further speed up their imposition of this technotronic advanced slave society. I believe right now is what you're doing, Alex, is what Dan is doing, is what I'm doing right now. We just need to unlock people's minds, wake them up.
So it's all about theater of the mind, what Charlie Veach was just saying about selling you that you're going to be snatched, you're going to be grabbed. Don't come out to these. Don't mess with the bankers. This is an exercise in warring against us. We're the legitimate people saying we don't want to be raped by the foreign banks. We don't want to go into serfdom like Greece or Iceland. And they're saying, no, you're going to feel our full might. And so they are testing, and they admit this at each of these events, how to bring in their internationalization of a city, how to have secret police, how to have their criminal operation dominate everyone. This is about the city and your state, your region, your country, going under globalist control. And they are under globalist control in these events. This is about your city going under foreign private corporate control. And now they're openly saying, yes, we're going to track you. Yes, we're going to spy on you. Yes, we're going to shut you down. Yes, we want to arrest people that tell conspiracy theories. I mean, what do they think is going to happen when they start trying to arrest people for their speech? Everybody's been fighting as hard as they can to keep this peaceful. But I don't think they realize we're not the poor, disarmed Russian peasants. We're not the disarmed Germans. And not everybody is a pot-bellied, decadent slob. I mean, I don't think all these little kids in black uniforms realize that they are really starting something that isn't going to end well. You notice as soon as they started selling derivatives in 99, they started setting up a police state. Because the IMF and World Bank have done this in countless third world countries. They've done this over and over and over again. They know what they're doing. And they know you're going to end up rioting. So I don't want violence, just like these anarchists gave this system a pretext to crack down. We want to peacefully go out and get the moral high ground and point out to the general public who the real criminals are. But down the road, they start trying to arrest political dissidents and take us to death dungeons. It's going to be like Robin Hood all over again. People aren't going to have a choice, and you will start seeing black arrows flying. And that's what happens when the badge and the government becomes a complete tyranny. I'm fighting to avert this as hard as I can, but as JFK said, those that make peaceful revolutions impossible make violent revolutions inevitable. Yeah, you're not in Kansas anymore, neither am I. This is bona fide real tyranny. And a lot of people say, well, I don't care if we live under tyranny. I go along, I got my job, I go along with what the government says. I submit to checkpoints and corruption and naked body scanners at the airports and the taxes always going up. I'm going to bend over. Well, they know you are, and that's why they're going to hurt you real bad. As Thomas Jefferson said, and as history shows, the level of tyranny you will live under is the exact level you'll put up with. They will not stop. The type of individuals in power worldwide throughout history are the types that always want more power. Listen, people say that cops can do no wrong in America. The media told us so. But did the Russian cops under Stalin and Lenin before him, were they bad? Were Hitler's police, the Gestapo, were they bad? Are Pol Pot's troops, were they bad? Was Pol Pot's police, were they oppressive? What about Fidel Castro? What about Mao Zedong? What about Julius Caesar? What about Attila the Hun? Oh, he had enforcers. So I'm here trying to keep our police from being turned into that historically. Why did our founding fathers fight the Redcoats? They became oppressive police. Have you read the Declaration of Independence? Read what the government was doing then and ask yourself, is that what's starting to happen now? I talked to so many people who have means, who are intelligent, who are informed, and they'll go, okay, so what if sodium fluoride's poison? So what if GMO food's bad? Yeah, there's a world government. But still, the media says you're a kook if you're against that. I don't want to look like a kook. So you're going to lose everything. Lose the dollar, lose your sovereignty, lose your children's future. You're going to go along with all this because you want to look like you're a mainline person. Is it mainline to jump off a cliff? Is it mainline to go along with Hitler? I guess it is. That's why it was mainline to have human sacrifice every day in the Aztec kingdom 1,000 years ago. It's totally insane, anti-human, satanic, but it's mainstream, so why not? When in Rome, do as the Romans do. You don't even control your own destiny when you just, like flotsam and jetsam, just get thrown around in the waves, whichever way the wind blows you. You're only alive once. Be part of standing up for humanity. It shows how brainwashed these people are that so many of these yuppies now will admit everything we're talking about is true, but say, what are you going to do about it? They have no respect for themselves. Well, it doesn't matter if they want to be slaves. Those of you out there that do hear the calling, that have looked into this information, that know it's true, it's your job to stand up against this evil and take action. And it's a great honor to be part of this. You're only alive once. We're alive at such an important time. Every generation has gone through critical crossroads, but this is the most critical in our history. The very survival of our species is at stake. Ladies and gentlemen, when they get rid of the Bill of Rights and Constitution, when they get rid of the Declaration of Independence, that's the shield for all of you. That protects all of us. They want tyranny so they can take all your pension funds. They want tyranny so they can conscript your children to be imperial stormtroopers in a global army to have their arms and legs blown off. They want tyranny so they can secure all their ill-gotten gains. Tyranny will target every one of you out there listening. And all of you good old boys and yuppies and people who think you're part of the establishment, you better count the cost right now and decide which side you're on, liberty or tyranny. You better decide whether you're going to get off the bench and be part of the second American Revolution against tyranny to restore the Republic, or whether you're going to sit there and suck your thumb and let all of this come to fruition. We need intelligent, able-bodied men and women who understand what's going on, doctors, lawyers, scientists, others, police officers, to stand up and be heard now, now, now. Now is the time.
Oh! has now been 11 days of peace since my ordeal that I was subjected to by the Toronto Police Department in connection with my free speech at the G20 summit protests. I would like to state categorically that I was held as a political prisoner by a severe system which cared not for jesting or jokes, but was interested only in the vindictive and vengeful stripping of personal freedom in an attempt to discourage dissent and suppress criticism, sentient criticism of a machine that is long overdue to evolve. I firstly want to thank all the supporters who showed great community spirit in making it known that I was kidnapped twice, and for all your messages of support and donations which keep this dream alive and kicking. I also want to say that I'm amazed at all the well wishes of the Canadian people who have written to me by the hundred apologizing for the behavior of their law enforcement. To them I say, do not apologize, this is not a Canadian problem, but an international issue of whichever nation has become the bitch of the global elites and the whore of the IMF and World Bank in our brutally globalized world. Alas, thank you, I had no idea of the reaction of the outside world once I was incarcerated. I bow down before you all in gratitude, in humble thanks. I would also like to thank the Toronto Police Department and whoever gives them their orders for their great contribution they've given to the global philosophical awakening. By exposing your hand in the cosmic poker match, you show that you do not serve and protect, but rather control and suppress. We saw your agent provocateurs smashing the city. We witnessed your urban civilian roundup drills and mass internments. I felt firsthand the boot of tyranny upon my face as I was given a 2-day prison sentence without committing any crime. I, briefly, for 48 hours, experienced what it is like to be in a mass prison warehouse. I endured the psychological torture and humiliation. I patiently awaited my release from your hell, meditating on the joys of liberty and the far worse fate endured by political prisoners all around the world whose sentences are measured not in days, but in years. Thank you, Toronto Police, for lashing out and showing where you are in need of dramatic change. Thank you for bringing the true horror of your machine to the mainstream. Thank you for accelerating change by acting like the pathetic and scared bully that you are. Your contribution will not be forgotten. You have shown me the horror of loss of liberty, and you've cemented my commitment to the evolution and revolution of mankind. The Love Police is stronger and more robust after the lessons learnt at the G20 Toronto events. Once again, thank you. Rather than a group of savages as portrayed in the media, I met only peaceful and humanitarian-minded souls at the G20 protests. I learnt that I have so much in common with Canadians as we are brothers and sisters calmly trying to reason with the liars and murderers with machine hearts and machine minds. The solidarity I felt with you all as we stood our ground to the stormtroopers with the rubber bullet shotguns pointed at us is a feeling I will never forget. We got through to some of the militarized police, many of whom smiled eagerly at us, many more who hung their heads in shame at the orders they were not brave enough to disobey. We send a message of forgiveness and remind you that redemption is a trait most respected in humanity, and that today is the day you can turn your life around. You are not a badge. You are not a gun. You are not a robot. You are a human being being used to control and hurt your human family here on Earth. Do not stand for it. I am one man, but I am also the tens of thousands who supported me, who stand by me, and the countless and faceless amazing people who send their warmth. I have nothing to hide and do not want to run and be a fugitive. I live in a world of human beings, and I trust that in my heart that common sense will prevail, and that we can teach the Toronto Police a lesson in civility. There is no opposition, but rather disappointment at my treatment. Free speech is a foundation of all liberty, for it follows that those who wish to control what we say will attempt to control what we think. We can never let this happen, for our forefathers did not fight and sacrifice their lives in order for the very fascism we opposed to be implemented at home. It should never have come this far, but as they say, if you're going through hell, keep going. There is no surrender. There is no taming of the wildness inherent in colonized minds returning to independent thinking. Liberty is timeless, and the time for freedom is yesterday, tomorrow, today. With much love and thanks, Charlie Veach, Love Police Undercover Detective.